Hello, and welcome to the TI Precision Lab series on current sense amplifiers. My name is Kyle Stone, and I am a product marketing engineer in the current and position sensing product line. In this video, we will discuss and analyze how the output impedance curve of a current sense amplifier can be utilized to ensure stability of the output. Current sense amplifier stability is a load-dependent parameter. Often, an amplifier that is stable with a resistive load may ring or oscillate when attempting to drive a capacitive or inductive load by itself. Common loads driven by amplifiers often include these type of reactants, such as filters for signal conditioning, capacitors chosen for charge bucket filters, and sample and hold circuitry, commonly found in analog to digital converters or ADCs. Impedance, like any AC gain transfer function, is a common function over frequency having magnitude and phase, and can be represented using Bode plots to simplify the analysis. Here, the magnitude and phase plots of the ideal resistive or purely real impedance and reactive or purely imaginary impedance elements are shown. These correspond to the passive elements of the resistor, inductor, and capacitor. An inductor is a representation of a transfer function zero, while the capacitor is a representation of a pole. Keep in mind that the linear appearance above is the result of using logarithmic scales for both magnitude and frequency axes. The traditional method for evaluating the impact of loading on the stability of a closed-loop amplifier involves analyzing Bode plots of the amplifier's open-loop gain magnitude and phase, and ensuring the system has sufficient phase margin for stability. This method examines the interaction between the loop gain, the load, and the amplifier's open loop gain, which includes open loop output impedance, or ZO, as it's commonly referred to in datasheets. To properly perform this type of analysis, breaking the amplifier loop and characterizing the amplifier's open loop gain is necessary. This, however, is not possible in the case of current sense amplifiers, as well as instrumentational amplifiers, because the gain feedback loop is internal to the device, thus the internal amplifier's open loop gain and open loop output impedance are unknown. Shown here is a brief review of Bode plot behaviors and how they relate to poles and zeros in the imaginary plane. A key factor to note when examining certain types of loading effects is that the peak in the Bode plot can indicate a pair of either right half plane or left half plane complex conjugate poles in the transfer function, which can indicate instability issues if not properly compensated for. The formal definition of impedance is the current to voltage transfer gain over frequency of an electrical circuit or component. Let's consider a test circuit where a small signal AC input current of variable frequency is injected, and the response of the resulting change in voltage at the test frequency is measured. Impedance is then calculated by applying Ohm's law to the recorded changes in voltage and current. The unknown impedance Z block is excited by the time-varying small signal current, I load of frequency F, with the other terminal driven to a fixed DC voltage. If V drop F and I load F are both measured at two separate time instances, T1 and T2, then by using KVL and Ohm's law, the following two equations are derived. Subtracting these equations from each other, we arrive at the final expression. Delta V drop and delta I load represent the changes in V drop and I load between the two time instances T1 and T2. As a result, we see the input voltage term canceled, and therefore there is no difference in the value of delta V drop, whether it is measured with respect to the input voltage VDC or with respect to ground. This implies by this setup, using small signal analysis, a small perpetuation current can be placed at the output of the device, and the ratio of the resulting change in voltage will be the output impedance of the device. This test setup can also be used to verify the output impedance curve of the amplifier in SPICE and ensure that it is present for proper stability analysis. Note that for the model to properly converge when working with current sense amplifiers, the device must be biased to a specific operating condition, which means that the input terminals must fall inside the common mode voltage specification, and the output voltage must remain inside the linear swing specification. For the shown test circuit, a small differential voltage of 5 millivolts is applied at the common mode voltage at 0 volts to achieve this requirement. For bidirectional devices, often the inputs may simply be grounded and the reference set to mid-supply to satisfy this requirement. Vout is an increasingly common specification in datasheets, in SPICE macro models of TI current sensing and precision amplifier products. There are two types of output impedance to be considered for amplifier circuits, open loop and closed loop. One must be careful to understand which impedance a datasheet is discussing, as often ZO is used interchangeably to refer to both open loop and closed loop output impedance for a system. Texas Instruments uses the convention that ZO will always refer to the open loop impedance of the device, while Zout will refer to the device's closed loop impedance. From the previous slide, it was shown that the closed loop impedance was the change in voltage at the output divided by the change in load current of the amplifier. Examining the abstract output model of an amplifier and performing KVL analysis from the load current source through the amplifier's open output, it can be derived that the closed loop output impedance of an amplifier is simply the open loop impedance divided by 1 plus the loop gain of the amplifier. This means that a current sense amplifier's Z out is a function of its internally set loop gain and open loop output impedance. Since the open loop gain and open loop output impedance are unknown, engineers must analyze the stability using the interaction of Z out and the load. To analyze the effects on current sense amplifier stability, we will examine the INA 293, which according to its datasheet, exhibits a double inductive curve beyond frequencies of approximately 18 kHz. This means that the output impedance grows at roughly 40 dB per decade over this range of frequencies. With double inductive impedance curves, resistive loads may yield small, underdampened responses, and capacitive loads greater than the datasheet specification will yield unstable responses. Examining the output impedance curve from the INA 293 datasheet, we can see that for the inductive portion of the curve at a frequency of 30 kHz, the output impedance of the device is approximately 0.2 ohms, or roughly negative 14 dB. Moving one decade over to 300 kHz, the impedance becomes approximately 15 ohms, or 23.52 dB. The difference of these points is close to, but not quite, 40 dB. This is due to higher order pole interactions in the curve, as can be seen in other fluctuations of the Bode plot. This proximity to 40 dB, however, shows that the INA-293 has an approximate double inductive curve for its output impedance inside this region, and may exhibit issues when driving capacitive loads. From the test circuit we derived earlier, an unloaded AC sweep of the INA-293 TINA splice model gives the following response over frequency, which closely matches the curve presented in the datasheet. Often, test equipment cannot realistically measure impedances this low, and the output data is limited to the realistic measurement capabilities of the capturing device, rather than the theoretical value calculated. The presence of this behavior with the INA-293 model verifies the model was designed to match data sheet Zout, thus cannot be used to investigate device stability when driving various loads in the splice simulation. Here, we've overlaid the unloaded INA-293 frequency response with that of an ideal 10 nanofarad capacitor. According to the INA-293 datasheet, this is 20 times more capacitance than the INA-293 is specified to drive without sustained oscillations. So we would expect there to be an issue visible in the Bode plot. Note that in real-world simulation, the capacitor chosen would also exhibit a resonance frequency and an inductive response beyond that frequency that would also appear in the response of the device. This should also be taken into account when performing this type of analysis to ensure that the expected capacitance is being seen by the output of the amplifier. Invoking the old adage of the path of least impedance, we can see that the Bode plots integrate at a cross point and that the overall system response follows the impedance path of whichever output impedance is lowest. The summation of these two plots, Z equivalent, is the transfer function of the output node. Also taking the load into account, we can see that due to the intersection of Z load and Z out in the double inductive region, a pair of complex poles is generated at roughly 550 kHz and is the source of our instability. While we can also examine phase margin here, the transfer function of this scenario is a third-order polynomial with complex poles and zeros. And the analysis is non-trivial, so we will look for other methods to satisfy stability here. Perturbing the INA-293 with a series of 50 millivolt step responses, we would expect outputs of 1.2 volts, 2.2 volts, and 3.2 volts. The simulation begins offset by 10 millivolts to ensure the device operates in the linear region, but the observed outputs are anything but what we expected. As the Bode plot analysis informed us for this load combination, there is clearly a set of complex poles and they are located in the right half plane. As the response not only oscillates, but increases the error up to the limits of the supply. As mentioned previously, the analysis of this sort of system is not easy. As a double inductive output impedance driving a capacitive load results in a third order polynomial equation. However, we can often approximate the system as a second order system, treating the output impedance of the device as a single inductance, 20 dB per decade. increase. In extreme cases, additional inductance may also be added at the output to ensure that this approximation holds. Examining the expression of a second-order LC transfer function, we can look at the expression of the poles and ensure that they are real to stabilize the output. To find an approximation of the inductance, we can choose any point on the INA293 output impedance curve that falls within the double inductance point, and use it to approximate the value of the inductance. Here, 100 kHz is chosen, which exhibits an impedance of 2 ohms at this frequency. From the calculation, we get 3.18 microhenry, and this shows that to ensure the poles remain real, a resistance of greater than 35.6 ohms is needed. Much like a second order system, we can clearly see that a resistance is placed in line with a capacitor. The equivalent impedance shifts upwards, slowly negating the effects of the complex conjugate poles, until the system returns to a clear RC roll-off at the added resistance between approximately 40 and 60 ohms. This is in line with our previous approximation, and we can expect that the response should now exhibit that of a typical RC response. Examining the transient response of the same resistors, we see that a resistance of 60 ohms also exhibits a standard RC curve, eliminating significant overshoot and corresponding to the formed RC time constant of 600 nanoamps, as roughly 2.4 microseconds are needed to settle, correlating to 4 time constants for a 98% settling time. Keep in mind that the introduction of this resistor will not only introduce an RC time constant that must be taken into effect, but will also introduce a small offset error at the output node. In addition, the clock curves of the amplifier should also be examined to ensure that the amplifier is capable of supplying the necessary current demanded by the load resistance for proper drive capability. If faster responses are desired, a high-speed buffer is often the easiest way to accomplish this. That concludes this video. Thank you for watching. For more information and videos on CurrentSense amplifiers, please visit ti.com/CurrentSense. For additional information on closed-loop output impedance analysis, please check out closed-loop analysis of load-induced amplifier stability issues using Zout on ti.com.